Welcome back, everybody. For those of you who tuned in last week to Our Mind on Music, you will have heard my conversation with Peter Noonan about reframing creativity. We were careful not to limit that to in the music classroom, because really we're talking about reframing creativity in general. In this week's continuation of that conversation, Peter and I will talk about some of the specifics of choosing repertoire. Also, we'll discuss a little bit about some of our inspirations, some of the areas that this way of approaching music education allows us to explore. And we'll even touch a little bit on AI in the music education world today. I hope you'll enjoy the rest of this conversation with Peter Noonan of Yokohama International School as we continue to explore reframing creativity.
I tell them from the beginning, I was like, you know, at the beginning, it'll be a democracy. Later, it'll be a bad democracy, which is what we all live in anyway. Like, I'm not going to put every single option up there, but I'm going to tell you why I'm not going to put every option up there. Some of them, I don't think are super level appropriate for us right now. It's either too easy. Like, we've done enough four chord songs. I don't want to do the weekend again. You've already done this. Or, you know, this is going to take us a really long time to do. Sometimes that's cool, but sometimes we want to, like, you know, we've got a concert coming up in 3 weeks and let's pick a song that we can kind of move. And you know what? The more you do this, the less time it takes. My seniors, I am completely unimportant in the room. They do this. They talk through it. They create the song. And in the IBDP, they actually have to do that as individuals anyway. For their presenting portfolio, they have to put together bands, they have to rehearse them, they have to create their own arrangements, and then they have to star in the show. And by the time they get to grade 11, they do all this on their own. It's perfectly, like, I'm unnecessary. And the cool thing is even new kids that are coming in from out of bounds, they pick up the culture from their peers way better than they pick it up from me trying to force it. I mean, if you think about, again, going back to language, kids that are like multilingual speak like their friends. They don't speak like their parents. You know, they don't have like British accents at our school, even though their parents might have a really thick Australian accent. They sound this third culture international school. I mean, it does end up being very North American sounding, but not, you know, like not even how I spoke growing up.
I don't think
but that's cool.
How I spoke growing up currently.
Yeah, no, exactly. I mean, we start to assimilate to all of the culture around us, and that's good and bad, but that's, you know, that's the way it is. And so they learn that classroom culture from peers way faster than they learn it from me. But I like to, I tell them, like, when I'm choosing the music, I'm trying to expand. I'm trying to stretch you guys a little bit. I'm trying to force you guys to do something that maybe you wouldn't normally do right away, but it's going to go back. You're going to have opportunities too, because I do want you to develop your taste. Right. And you know, democracy is sometimes how we do it. And sometimes it's more me kind of like giving constricted democracy, like you can choose from this, this, and this, or like, here's a topic, you guys kind of go find it. And then we choose together. And then we start building context out. And luckily that usually relates to the units that I've kind of built. And then we'll look at like a specific thing. So for example, in grade 7, I start looking at the blues and improvisation on top of the blues. And the thing I really care about is improvisation. So how do I get there? The 12-bar blues is a form. It's cool. It's fun. A blues scale. It's fun. It's, you know, it's cool. But the thing I care about is you making something new. And so like finding blues songs together to play as a group that you can get right into improvising is what I care about. And that, if you think about that, even within those three types of creativity that I was talking about before, there's some that have a known problem. Like, I want you to pick a blues song. There's some that have no known problem. It's spontaneous. You guys can kind of choose from whatever you feel like. And then there's some like you have to respond to the thing in time. Like, I'm trying to do that. And I really try to come back to that a lot. Like, to me, it's very helpful as in my own thinking. And what I had talked about in Kobe in particular was really if I had to like explain it to someone, it's learning by ear, but as a class. Right. So unlike where a lot of like, I know a lot of the focus from the other speakers was really like learning by ear is the most important thing, which is true. And that's how musicians learn on their own. They very rarely get to do that in an ensemble setting. And for me, it really came about originally from Orff. When I was teaching like elementary back in the day, I loved these Orff concepts of like, okay, here's a bourdon, here's like the bass line that top, and then you can improvise with, I can take keys away from the Orff instruments and everything will sound pentatonic and it'll sound beautiful together. And, you know, my 2-year-old can already do that, right? And they, without ever having a technical limitation.
That's the first time thing I ever showed my kids. I have a son and a daughter, and when they were tiny, like before they could understand really what music was at all, that I showed them on the piano, if you play all the black keys, you can't really hit a wrong key.
Yeah. Oh man, I love that. I love that. And it feels good and it feels human to get right into that, right? But my problem with the Orff material that I had seen and the Orff teachers that I'd done workshops with, for me, was that it didn't bridge the gap to the kind of music that people were listening to, or like jazz, which is what I had studied and stuff like that. And I didn't want that to disappear either, right? So my whole goal at that time was, how the heck do I go from here to here? How do I make, like, what's the next iteration of Orff? And so I started looking at how we could learn songs. And I was reading actually one of those world pedagogy books, and they were using the word enacted listening. And I was like, you know what? That's actually a much better word than learning by ear for me. That makes more sense. Because when I hear people say to learn by ear, it used to piss me off. I'd be like, what does that mean? How do you do that? Is this magic? Like, what are the processes to do that? And I've been for years trying to figure out what those processes are for me. I'm not saying it's true for everyone.
I'm still trying to figure it out now. Even like I said, I've been doing this way of teaching and learning for 20 years, and I'm learning new ways to approach it. So yeah, I hear you.
And the Gimmel stuff, the Gordon music stuff, really was mind blowing in terms of that. And then there's a website that I really love called Hook Theory. I talked a little bit about it at the workshop, but I got to work with some of those guys really early on. They were at UC Berkeley, and they were kind of developing this like super scaffolded way of playing with harmony initially. And then it accidentally turned into this database that is like Wikipedia, where you simplify, anybody can contribute to it like Wikipedia, and anybody can fix stuff like Wikipedia. And I looked this morning, because I was giving it to some student that was going to be starting her extended essay, and there was 48,000 songs. Like 2 months ago, it was 46,000 songs. Like it grows exponentially like Wikipedia does. And it's simplified. It's tonal, right? It simplifies everything to a really simple melody or really simple harmony. I mean, it doesn't have to be a simple harmony. It can be as complex as you need it to be, but it's really visual and it looks like piano roll type of stuff. Okay. And the chords look like Lego bricks. And to analyze, to me, it's like a scaffolding analysis, which is really cool. And the guys that were like kind of developing this at UC Berkeley, like, were so amazing about asking for feedback and making the changes. And now it's just this really robust, fun way to write music, where it's not complex. It's really easy for people to jump on there, or to represent the tonal music that we're learning through enacted listening. Like, we're listening to it, I'm making it happen. That's what I think of enacted listening, right? And I used to call it transcribing, but I don't always write it down. You know, like when I was going to school for jazz, like, you got to transcribe this lick, right? It's like, cool, but I'm not always writing that down. Sometimes I'm just being able to play it. And that's more important, you know?
Right.
So,
I mean, yes, because early days when I first started teaching kids in the way that they were choosing the material back then, I think I had probably had some internet access, but in Venezuela in 1998, it wasn't a lot of access, you know?
Yeah, right. So, wow.
And so when I was doing that, so that's more than 20 years actually. Anyway, but so I used to have to literally write it down. And man, that was really hard, because sometimes, like,
oh, man,
is that an eighth rest followed by an eighth note? Or is it a, you know, like, ugh. And then when DAWs started coming out, and I could just play it on a keyboard, and then it would just turn it like GarageBand does now, right? Like Cubase was doing that early days. You play it and then you click, click, and it'll open it up into notation of what you just played correctly.
Oh, yeah.
And I was like, that.
Yeah.
That
and that's the dream, right? Like, you want technology for like a learning thing to be like a tool here. And that tool takes away some of the challenges of, for example, rhythmic transcription and all that kind of stuff, if you can just play it. But even back then, like you could record yourself and then I could go back to listen to that recording. As long as I was able to like get that thing down in time, I could go back and figure it out again. And that's often how I did it when I was younger and I didn't know about diatonic harmony, right? Like the coolest thing about Nirvana, and I go back to that again, mostly because they're power chords. And one of the weird things that happens with power chords is that the listener fills in the thirds. They fill in whether it's a major or minor. And so as long as you're playing accidental notes of a scale, which I promise you Kurt Cobain did not know, you know, you can listen to it and tell that he didn't know these things, and that's great. It still sounded rich enough, especially with lots of distortion. The distortion actually brings out the thirds in physics anyway. And people listen to it and like, man, this is so cool. But physically, it's so easy to play. Now, if we could do that with like all of diatonic chords, then all of a sudden it gets to be really interesting, right? It gets to be a way that we're into it. And that's what anecdotist listening and the way that I've been thinking of it is for it. But that's actually only one focus in my classroom. That was my main focus in Kobe. But like I said, concurrently, I always have these other creative verbs going on. So like composition, improvisation, creative listening, you know, even like reacting with our body. So like, I love, oh man, I'm obsessed with Brad Meldow, you know him, he's a pianist. He's originally from the States, but he's based out of, I think, Berlin.
I've been trying to work a lot on groups of five against four.
Everything he does is just more amazing than the thing before to me. Like he actually, we were talking about fugues before. It was because of him that I got started in that. He released this album where he learned like a Bach fugue, and then he would create a fugue improvisationally the way that Bach would do it in response to it, but using modern language. Then he would do the next fugue, and then he would, and so he called it After Bach. And so like, it's just so cool. And it was because of that. I was like, yeah, I should really check out fugues. I should, but he's done so much stuff like that. He's a pianist and he did this album with Joshua Redman, who's a sax player. It's just such a fun song. And I get the kids to start doing body percussion to that song, but I don't give them any, like, I don't tell them how to do the body percussion at all. I just say, you've got to respond to this with body percussion. You are now the drummer, but you're only allowed to use your body. That's it.
Yep.
And instantly they start reacting to that music in a way and listening in a creative way that I couldn't do any other way. Like if they had the technical limitation of like, you have to play along with it, they're going to start thinking, okay, where's the tonal center? Where is this? But rhythmically, they're able to just jump right into it. And like the more you can get into those creative verbs, that's the things I want them to take away after their time with me, right? Because I want the kids to play
right
after they're with me. I don't want them to stop.
Well, now you've said two things, but one was when you introduced the body percussion in Kobe, you didn't say that. You didn't call it anything. You just did it. You gave very minimal, if any, instruction, and you just sort of started doing this.
Yeah.
And then made the sign to us that we were supposed to repeat, and we all got it, and we all did it, and it was like nonverbal, you know, which I thought was cool. Like, and so then afterwards, you said like, I could do this with students. I can say basically nothing. If you just go, people will repeat that. You know,
absolutely. You know? And that's like a human, so that gets into a really interesting thing, like in modes that we learn, right? So one of the most powerful modes that we learn is by watching others. There's a really famous study about monkeys eating red berries, and the monkeys will not eat these red berries until they see another monkey eat it and find out that it's not poisonous, right? So there's something evolutionary in our brain to learn that way and learn very quickly that way. And to be honest, a lot of this scaffolding that teachers think they're doing is actually taking, it's wasting time. It's a huge waste of time. If I just sit down and start playing and the kids start seeing it and they start doing it way faster than me saying, put your finger on the fourth fret on the E string. If I just sit down and do it, they're like, oh yeah. And that's true for body percussion. That's true for playing. And if I don't say anything, that's also provocation too. They're like, oh, why is he not saying anything? The silence is weird. I feel like I have to do this. And you can get into really complex things if you think about it as a teacher beforehand. How much can you do without saying anything?
It's like that social experiment where there's somebody waiting in a dentist's office. Have you seen this? And everybody else in that setting is an actor. And what they do is every once in a while, a bell will ring, I think it is, and everybody stands up.
Yeah.
And then the person in the office is like, what are you guys doing? And the third, fourth time the bell rings and everybody stands up, they stand up with them. It's really powerful that just to see people doing it, they want to imitate.
So one of the cool things that Orff used to do is he kind of split it up into those baseline, harmony, ostinato, melody, ostinato, and then color. And then rhythm is kind of like the thing that we add on nowadays too. But like every single one of those musicians that's going to be playing also learns those other parts. Right. And the way that you can teach that is you teach just a small group of Bourdon, the bass line. You teach just a small group the harmony, and you don't even have to like show them. I mean, you could show them what you're doing and they can kind of follow you on whatever instrument, and then the melody. And then you don't have to teach the next group. You let them kind of rotate and their peers are teaching themselves. And it's even once more removing you. Right.
I've done that. Well, not that specifically, but I've done something similar that you triggered my memory saying that, because I remember I did this thing where I would have a student come up to the drum set and I'd say, okay, here's the beat you're going to play. And I'd show them and they'd imitate it. No notation at all. I'd play it, you know, as, you know, straightforward, like kick, snare kind of thing. All right. They can play that. Good. I walk away and I say, bass player, you're going to play this. Right. And then the guitar player, you're going to play this chord, whatever. And I go through the whole section and then I say, okay, great. Now that we've set up this whole group, I want you to switch one position to, let's say, to the left.
Yep.
And they're like, well, but I don't know how to play the drums. Well, that's okay, because Johnny is going to show you, because he can play it now. So he's going to show you. And then, yep. And so that's what they do, is then they just keep on rotating until everybody in that group has played each of the instruments shown by the other student, you know?
That's it. And then you get the experience as a learner of teaching, which means that you have to consolidate that thinking, yeah, and learning from peers, which means that you're going to learn it way faster and it's going to mean more. And it's like, again, I go back to that problem of the way that I learned music, which was there was so much waiting. There was so much waiting. I had to wait for everybody else to learn their part. Whereas this way, I'm teaching the person next to me how to learn it. And as a teacher, time goes by way faster. My life is easier. I very rarely teach technical parts of the instrument anymore. I use YouTube videos that they find. Sometimes I find. I try to help them scaffold it. Going back to that process journal, the reason I use that Google form is they are recording themselves playing at some point of those three things, the warm-up, the learning something new, and the repertoire. And then I can go through and I can watch a lot of those videos and decide, like, are they kind of in the right path? And then I'll maybe give them a hint. But they can also see that spreadsheet of their friends practicing. And I used to have a huge debate with one of my music teachers when I first was doing this. He was like, you can't do that. I was like, what do you mean I can't do this? He's like, it's too much social pressure. You're going to have some kids that feel like, oh, they practice more than me, I'm not good enough. But actually, that was my intention. Like, that is a social pressure that actually makes us want to engage with our instrument more. And it's not always super positive. I get that, but it's still a motivating factor. And if it got to the point where it was too stressful, then of course I would try to remove that. But
I have used that something similar a lot with my students as well, where, you know, I'd say, okay, like, especially with choir, I'd say, okay, you're going to do sectional here. And so maybe, you know, maybe it's by soprano, alto, tenor, et cetera, or maybe it's groups within that. Whatever it is, before the end of class today, and I think I started this during the online COVID class time, before the end of class today, I want you to record where you are with that and share that to me through, you know, whatever the
edge
back or whatever it is, right?
So Yeah.
And that makes it gives them a goal so that it's not specific yep. to like you have to be able to sing this note and you have to do this set of checklist things. It's yep. just a goal for like showing their progress.
So what the next step, so I had a very similar iteration to you. The next step that I had was I wanted them to identify their goals beforehand a little bit yeah. and then to reflect later at the end of the process. So at the end of the semester, I have them because they've got this big repository of videos of them practicing over many weeks. They're going to pick a beginning, a middle, and an end of the process. And they're going to say, this is where I was. This is where I went next. And this is where I am now. And then this is what I want to do next. And then on top of that, I have them evaluate the resources they used, because in a way that's almost the most important skill, because they can continue that on after me. And I go back to that again a lot, because you could basically teach yourself almost any physical skill with YouTube now, which is awesome. The yeah. humanity has made things like this communal brain of YouTube, which is awesome. But there's a lot of garbage out there.
Well, yeah, but I mean, part of it is that, right? I've said to our TOK teachers, theory of knowledge in our school, that I think mm-hmm, mm-hmm. in a lot of ways, I see them as maybe the most important course in the whole school, because it makes you think about how you learn, right?
Absolutely.
Thinking about how you think and all that. But I think that's kind of the thing as a music teacher, I'm trying to teach myself out of being necessary for the student.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So if I can do that, and I've met my goal.
Yeah. I just, you know, like I got to this point where it didn't make sense when you have people that are much more expert on a lot of these instruments than I am. Like I couldn't play piccolo, you know, even if I had studied it for a while, compared to like a beginning piccolo video that you could find online. And there's some really wonderful resources out there. There's one called like Practicing Musician that's free. It's from the United States, and they have like a bit of scaffolded video textbooks that you can use for free. It's really amazing. And the way that they make their money is they help people rent instruments in the United States. So if you're outside of the United States, they're not even trying to get money from you. And it's just a free resource. It's wonderful. There's lots of other ones too. And I mean, YouTube is definitely the most important, but what I want them to do is to be able to evaluate that resource and say, is this really going to help me, or am I wasting my time here? And then also by doing that, they also have to evaluate themselves and say, like, is this what I need next, or is this too hard for me? And so we talk about that a lot. We talk about that as like when we're choosing our songs, is this song level appropriate for me right now? Yeah. And I don't say it in terms of Vygotsky's zone of proximal development, but I want them to figure that out on their own. I don't want them to have to worry about me telling them what they need to work on next, because
that's one of the things when I first started doing this, like I said, back in Venezuela, the first song I remember students choosing was Survivor by Destiny's Child. But for a lot of reasons, mostly because they loved it and they like really worked to learn it, I realized at that point, wait a minute, this makes sense to me, because there's all arpeggios in there. Da, 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 da. It's all arpeggios, right?
Yeah.
And then I'm teaching chords and I'm teaching rhythms and they're learning all this as we go. The second song I remember them choosing was Metallica, The Unforgiven. Took a long time because for students who had never played instruments before at all, mm-hmm. and for you know the instruments that we had at that time, mm-hmm. I started to think, okay, so what are the sort of frameworks that I need to help students set up before they choose mm-hmm. a song? You know, mm-hmm. is it mm-hmm. Are the lyrics appropriate? You know, is this something we can play within the time that we have?
Yeah,
you know, that was one of the things too.
So that just made me think of something. So like when I, the very first one that I ever did, I was teaching, it was actually like an orchestra program at the time. And I was not really an orchestra teacher. It just happened to be the demand of that school at that time. And I was a very new music educator, so I kind of just fit into whatever they needed. Mm-hmm. And the kids really wanted to play Rolling in the Deep. It was like the brand new song out. And I was like, oh, okay. I mean, it doesn't exist on like J.W. Pepper or anything, but I'll come up with an arrangement of it.
Yeah.
And that was my first like thing of like, okay, I've got to approximate this. And it's not hard, but how do I make swing notes without it being hard to play? And, you know, but then I started thinking, I was like, you know what? I can actually create the unit from the repertoire. Because it's like in this, you know, minor pentatonic, and this is grade six, and we can start talking about minor pentatonic, and it's got some interesting rhythm things that are going on. So I can talk about how to clap this thing because the chord changes before the downbeat of it. There was all these things that I could get from the repertoire to teach too, which is like your teacher before picking those kind of like etudes to help you get to that thing. Or sometimes we can go the opposite route. Like I can have these concepts that I want to focus on, and then we can find repertoire that fits within this. And the beauty of learning songs like this is I'm not kneecapped by what music is available to us. Like what can I buy in a flex band process from J.W. Pepper is going to be limited, and it's going to be songs that I don't like, maybe the kids like, or I have to write it myself, which is incredibly time consuming. And instead, if I can scaffold this learning by yourself, learning by ear, and then even arranging your own parts to it later, it's way more interesting. It's way easier. We're not handicapped by any limitations, or the only limitation is like time, really.
And there are resources now, talking to Chris, again, Chris Kulma, about Beginner Orchestra, which is called mm-hmm. Beginner Orchestra. So it sounds like it's for orchestra, but in fact, it's not. So you can ask them just through contact directly with Chris or one of his colleagues. I want an arrangement of this song, and I want it to have these instruments included. Can you guys do that? And you can just commission that work. So you don't necessarily have to sit down and do it like you and I have been doing, and like thousands of music teachers around the world. Do you have to sometimes write out the parts to arrange?
Yeah. I mean, that's absolutely true. I'm sure like in probably the next year or two, AI will be able to do that, you know, like, and that's cool. You know, that's a technical boon, I think, to AI. But like when all of those things start coming up of like, you know, what happens with AI and music? Is music even important anymore? The reason I think it will be is because the thing I care about music is the humanity aspect of it. Like AI is an approximation of a bunch of statistical things that, but it's not human. There's no humanity to it. And it's the accidental, you know, it's the creativity that comes from those ways of being creative that we had talked about that is most interesting to me. And well, I imagine it'd be interesting for.
I think that comes back to what you were talking about as authenticity. And I was talking about in terms of sincerity. For me, if there comes a time when AI can create, I don't know how this would even be possible, but if there comes a time when AI can create music that is sincere, which the implications are huge, but
yeah,
then I would listen to it and go, okay, that's great. But it reminds me of quantizing music when you
it takes a lot of soul out of it.
Perfection technically does not make music better. Hearing Thelonious Monk play with his band, you know, and thinking, what is this? Like, you know, his version of Just a Gigolo. You know,
I don't know that tune, actually. I've got to check that out.
I did a comparison of the Louis Prima version, then the David Lee Roth version of Just a Gigolo, and then the Thelonious Monk, you know?
Oh, cool, man.
Absolute maximum, I think, of how you can play behind the beat without being on the other.
Man. It's, you know, people are super interested in that right now. specifically because of like a couple of hip hop artists, you know, that have been playing with technical ways to make that happen and to make it sound human. J Dilla is like kind of a hip hop producer's producer.
Young man went out and made a name for himself. He's been on every record-breaking show in the Regal Theater in the last 2 years.
Was playing with like an MPC, like a drum trigger, like a sample trigger. And he found that like you could tweak individual tracks to be on different quantizations. So you can quantize the snare to be at the front of the beat, and you can quantize other parts to be all together. And it became a sound, and now everybody steals from J Dilla, like, and they reference it, but now there's live drummers trying to play like him. And it's really, really complex to be able to play like that. There's this educator that I really love. He's become very famous on YouTube. His name's David Bruce, and he's a composer, and he comes from like a classical background, but he started looking at J Dilla and how he humanized all of these tracks, specifically playing around with like quantization and the quirkiness of quantization. And then he composed like full orchestra stuff using that same technique. So it is interesting to me how human even those things can be, and maybe AI will be one day. I mean, maybe it will. The reason that I respond to art is because of the humanity in it. And, you know, even when I look at like those digitally created like DALL-E art things where they're like amalgamations of Van Gogh and all these things, it's like, yeah, they can be very beautiful. I'm not saying they can't be beautiful, but I don't think I quite call it art. Just like I can look at a waterfall and I can think it's really beautiful. And it can touch me in very similar ways that art does. Like I can get the hair sticking up on the back of my neck when I see an absolutely powerful, amazing waterfall. But do I consider that art? No, it's something different. It's its own thing, and that's okay.
In one of the early episodes of this podcast, Our Mind on Music, I spoke with Kirby Ferguson. Are you familiar with Everything is a Remix?
Yes. Yeah. That's fantastic. A great TED talk, man. I used to use that a lot, actually. That's cool that you got to talk to him.
Yeah, it was really cool. And exactly the same thing. We used to use his TED talk in a school that I worked at in Kazakhstan. And I saw he had brought out this stuff about AI, and I was talking about AI at the time, like everybody else. And I just messaged him and said, hey, would you be interested in talking on my podcast about this? And he said, yes. And I was like,
oh, cool. Oh. That's awesome.
So cool.
Yeah.
One of the things he said, so many things that I thought were really insightful. And on top of that, he's amazing at editing video. He's like so talented.
Oh, yeah.
One of the things that he said was that thing about the humanity piece. How is what AI is doing? How do you see it as being different? Or do you see it as being different from the way humans create?
Unlike some people, I do not think that this software has any sort of intelligence or anything like that. They don't have awareness. We are the only creatures that create art. There's no other life forms on this planet that create art. So we are aware, we are sentient, we know that we exist. So, like, you can criticize yourself when you have awareness. You can look at what you've done and you can compare it to other people and you can evolve it. So there's just a lot that goes on with being aware of what you have done and knowing that other people are doing other things. AIs have none of that awareness, right?
At least to me confirms that idea about the sincerity. Like what you just said, AI art can be beautiful, right? But he said, make no mistake, this is still a recreation. There's no consciousness there. And that's why, for me, I think it's a long stretch to say, will AI ever feel sincere? Because it would have to first have consciousness of what it's creating.
Yeah. You know? So I mean, it might be able to fake it. And then you get to this point, like, if it's faked, who cares if it's real? I don't know. I agree with you. And I also have learned to not underestimate the speed which technology takes over, because there's so many things that I just never even dreamed would exist, like in our own lifetime. Seriously, yeah. Like just being able to slow down a YouTube video without it changing pitch, I would have killed for that as a like young musician, to be able to learn things through enacted listening, you know, like, and every time I say that, I feel
rewinding my cassettes with a pencil, or, you know, yeah, those types of things.
Slowing stuff down on a vinyl so you can try to figure it out, but then you had to figure it down an octave or, you know, a fifth below, and then you had to convert it. Like, it was so, oh man. And, you know, like when I start this, all my kids just like glaze over, like, all right, old man, like, what are you doing?
Yeah, hello, but, last century. We're talking to you from 2024 now.
you know, one place that I really felt, have you ever played with Staff Pad on the iPad? Originally, it was actually Microsoft that developed it, but basically it's a notation software. You can write directly onto notation and it'll play exactly like what you write there. And it'll also do all kinds of musicological stuff. But on top of that, it uses really amazing sound libraries. So you can use like the Berlin Orchestra sound libraries. You can use like the cinematic ones. Like, they're so cool, like the Cinebrass and all those ones. And it's like you have the ability. Have you ever watched Amadeus? And there's that scene where the music is the third character, him and Salieri, like he's on his deathbed and he's like, no, and then this happens, but the music is actually happening between them in the movie. It's like you have that magic, because that's audiation. That is audiation, right?
Yep.
And that's audiation between two people, which is even more amazing. But it's like you have that ability through technological scaffolding with Staff Pad. You have the ability to hear what it sounds like as you change this thing, which takes years and years to be able to get to Mozart's ability, you know, like, but you have it instantaneously, which is like technologically a dream. So cool. It's expensive, but it's really fun. Yeah, super fun. I don't know, because we went in a lot of different directions. I don't really know how to wrap it up into a clean bow. But I guess if I was forced to, I would say the thing that I have been thinking about the most as a music educator is starting from the premise that music and language are a continuum, then looking at like a more natural way to experience like all of those verbs, all of the verbs of music and language, and how to kind of make sense of them in a more natural developmental way. And then the awesome implications that come from that, the really fun implications of coming from that. Because even for me as a music educator, it's way more fun to teach this way, because every semester it's new music. Every semester there's surprising things that come about. It allows for like new kids coming in with completely different levels of ability to instantly be part of it. And there's no upper boundary. Like, you know, there's no point where it's like, I've learned my part, I'm waiting for everyone else, you know, now it's time to improvise then. Okay, cool. Let's open this up. Why don't you write some parts for these people here? And like, you know, and then
while there are no boundaries north and south, there are also no mm-hmm. boundaries east and west, you know, like,
absolutely.
To think about music in terms of genre, like in week one of semester one, we're going to teach classical music, and then we're going to teach romantic, and then we'll see if we get to impressionist or, you know,
Right.
Romantic, whatever.
Yeah.
No, I mean, one of the ways that I approach that is by just looking at unit one is these two elements of music, and whatever you guys choose, or whatever, however we approach choosing what we're going to study, at the end of the day, we're going to focus in, like, see all of it, but every once in a while, we'll focus in through this lens of mm-hmm. dynamics. Absolutely. And rhythm, or
yeah,
whatever the things are, you know. So it's
and like, those things have to keep coming back, right? Like, you can't just do it as a one-off thing, but like the next time we experience rhythm, it's going to be a much more complex thing, and there's genres that work for that, and then there's, you know, there's cultures of music around the world where like rhythm is what it's all about. And you know, you have this freedom as an educator to kind of move also dynamically the where your kids are. You know,
like, I was thinking about that. Sorry, it's not about.
Well, I was going to say, it's not about like even what I necessarily want you to learn next. It's like, you guys are into this rhythm thing. Let's make this happen. Let's blow this up and like, and go as far down this tangent as we want to, because it's fun.
Well, that's the coolest thing. Once they know what those elements of music that you know, if I define a finite list just so that it's manageable, not because I think there aren't other things possible, you know, like if you you know the Dr. Smith acronym, dynamic rhythm structure melody, and then the I and the T in Dr. Smith, H is harmony, but I and T, it's like, is I intonation or is it instrumentation? Is T timbre, tone? What is it? Yes. The answer is yes to all of those things.
Yeah. Oh, interesting.
So
it's funny because like the old iteration of the IB required a lot of musicological analysis. And so I felt really bounded. Like I have to teach all of this. I have to get you to have understood like what an augmented sixth chord is and like all these things. And the new iteration, I swear, it's like they read like my theory, like my manifesto, and really made some amazing changes where it's really not about that. Like you have this freedom to show your musicality, and their big lenses are music as a researcher, music as a creator, and music as a presenter. And to me, those are wonderful like verbs that we can really dig into in like really meaty ways. And it's not bounded by like, oh, the hardest thing is this 16th, 17th, 18th century Western art music, and that's all that matters. Instead, it's like, you know, there's jazz that's equally as challenging, and there's hip hop that's wildly amazing, and there's musical theater that is super important to a lot of my students. You know, like it doesn't have to be like, I'm not bounded by this, oh God, I've got to get this much stuff done, I've got to cover this much content. And that, I love that. I thank them.
If I were to take one nugget out of what we talked about over this full conversation, one of the things is that example that you gave of how to scaffold and frame a certain way of listening, you know, creative listening, without then, by nature of the scaffolding, limit the student's approach to it, you know?
Right.
That's one of the things that I will definitely be taking away from this conversation, that I'm thinking, wow, how can I, to what extent can I apply that to everything I do in the class now? You know, because the way you're just talking about appreciating music or approaching it, it doesn't limit us to a place in time. It doesn't limit us to a style of music. And, you know, everything we talked about with Jennifer Walden about, you know, ways to really see your class in a global way. So world music is any music from the world, you know?
Like, oh man, that term used to bug me so much when I started teaching internationally. It was like, you're actually creating a separation of colonialism right now by saying world music and then real music.
Well, like, that's what Chris posted. So Jennifer's doing these online courses called World Music Pedagogy. And then the way that it's stated through the music teachers in international schools is, do you ever cringe at the term world music?
And, you know, as you travel, and you've been, I'm sure, around the world, you've told me about Georgia and you live in China, so I'm sure you've traveled a lot. Like, it's just so enjoyable to experience that humanity, right? Like that culture, whether it be food, whether it be conversation, if you can speak the same language, but musically, it just feels so human to experience that. Like, to me, it's
and
so
not as an other thing. It's like that, like food, like. One of the things, and again, that connected with me hugely because I'm a food traveler in a way. I'm a huge foodie. I love spices and things.
Yeah, man.
And so that was one of the things. I mean, talk about in Tbilisi, like Georgia, for the wine, which I'm not even a wine drinker, but my goodness, their wine is amazing. And their food, like, it must be a sommelier's paradise to go to that country.
Oh, man, that's awesome. I really want to go. I've never been.
Oh, definitely go.
You just made me think. So like that is the analog for context of teaching context in music too, right? Like, you know, there's this famous study for wine in particular, where if you talk up like a bottle, it doesn't matter if it's expensive or not, people will result, and they do like functional MRIs showing that they actually have a better experience with it, right? We can have that same thing with music, absolutely. Like, or if I go back to the fugue, I didn't understand it. Now that I start to understand it, I have a love for it on a completely different level. And that's within Western classical music, you know? Like,
I think about experiencing Giant Steps, John Coltrane, right? don't know if this is true for everybody, but for me, I think I needed to have a little bit of an understanding of jazz. And then having heard Thelonious Monk, and then hearing that and understanding just, like, where is he going with this? Like, oh my goodness. And then A Love Supreme.
Even if you think about those as dialects within tonal language, like the tonal language of music, jazz is very, very different in some ways. And that's the genre of jazz, right? And and to be able to hear that many key changes within that short amount of bars, it's wild. It's so off-putting for a lot of people at first.
I was trying to explain, a friend of mine was saying, how can you like that? You know, and I said, well, for one thing, it's technically, like mathematically, really amazing what he did. That's kind of cool. But I can make technically, mathematically amazing music that sounds terrible. What's key to that, the magic part, is that he did that so that if you analyze it, you go, wow, that's so cool. And it sounds good. Dun, dun, dun,
There's a quote, man, that I use all the time, and it's Duke Ellington. And he's like, you know, in music, there's one rule. If it sounds good, then it is good. And that's so true, man.
Have you seen that little clip, Herbie Hancock talking about Miles Davis? He says there was a Miles solo, he's playing away, and Herbie Hancock hit the wrong chord in the middle of this solo. And he like cringed and he threw his hands up, which I always tell my students, never do that. If you make a mistake, look at somebody in the audience like, oh yeah, that's what that's exactly how I hope that goes. But Herbie Hancock says, Miles stopped his solo for a moment, looked over at him, and then played some notes and made the chord right, you know?
I've heard Miles say before, you know, any song is, or any note, no matter how wrong it is resolvable in either direction. Like, you go up a half step, and then all of a sudden it sounds good again, so you make it sound like a bend. Yeah. And you know, to me, like, actually that idea of non-reacting, and like I said before, I was really into the idea of like Buddhism and meditation practices, secular Buddhism, and mixing with music. I kind of started, have you ever heard of Kenny Werner? He's a jazz musician and a professor at NYU. And he wrote this book called Effortless Mastery. And one of the things that he talks about is actually practicing, not reacting. So you sit down at your instrument, you play like a tone cluster that you're going to have some kind of cringe feeling to, but you force yourself, you disrespect it, and you actually come to love the complexity of it. Like, when you first hear like a flat 9 chord, it sounds wrong. But the more you hear it, it becomes rich and colorful.
Have you heard gamelan music?
Yeah, man. Oh, man. I went to a bunch of gamelan shows and a bunch of Kachak shows, and I was just like stunned how cool they were.
My daughter and I were so lucky to participate in this gamelan workshop during a week without walls. And man, that was a perfect example. Like, when we first went to Sumatra, we lived in Sumatra for a year. First winter, we heard that music. I was like, this, you know, and it's like metal hitting metal, you know.
Do you know the story about Debussy? Because this happened with Debussy in the World's Fair. So he heard gamelan music. They came in the World's Fair way back when. So that was like the internet before internet. And then he ended up writing songs like Pagoda and stuff like that afterwards. And Debussy directly like credits the crazy tonality that accidentally comes up from gamelan music.
That's so cool.
In his like composition. And this is like a backwards, you know, focus. Like usually it's classical music imposing its stuff on everyone else. So yeah. Anyway, yeah, well, sorry, continue.
Well, I mean, Terry Riley with In C. I was commenting on one of our, actually, I think it was on my blog, one of my blog posts, I was commenting on In C by Terry Riley, when I was saying, to me, all I can hear is gamelan played on different instruments. And I wrote that, posted it somewhere, I think it was on Twitter or something. And do you know Ted Gia, the music journalist? No. The History of Jazz, it's like, or it's sure amazing. You got to take it.
Yeah.
Cool, Ted Gia responded to the post saying, I met Terry Riley and I can confirm that, yeah, he was absolutely influenced by gamelan.
Oh, that's cool, man.
Yeah,
that's,
and I was cool. Like, but I didn't, when I first heard it, even as a music teacher, a lifelong lover of music, I was like, oh, what is that? You know, once I started to understand where it was coming from, it was a whole different experience. And then when I heard In C, I was like, this totally makes sense to me. And you can see notation of In C where it's just those little chunks of music and you can put them sort of in any
however you want to. Yeah,
you know,
that's so cool.
I love that concept. Yeah, so
well, it's I think, like, and Kenny Werner says, like, really you should be practicing that explicitly. You should practice that non-reaction at first and then that love for these sounds at first, because the thing is like with improvisation, and we talked about this before, it's ephemeral, it has to happen in time. The thing that usually takes you out of that flow state is when you start to become conscious of anything. And if you look at the neurobiology of that, that makes a lot of sense, right? Like if I am conscious, then all of a sudden I'm slowing stuff down at all. And you can't slow this stuff down. So you have to love everything you play, even the stuff that's wrong. You have to love it at that point.
I actually have my students doing that in classes now, or you know, have for a while, where if they make a mistake in class, they're still not allowed to like cover up their faces and cringe. They're still meant to, in performance, like in the classroom, they're still meant to roll with it and maybe look at me or another student.
Yeah.
And they laugh when they do that. They look at each other and they go like, and they
that's
laugh.
Great though, man. Dude, how many times has that happened on the bandstand? It's happened to me a billion times when like someone completely canks apart and you're just like, you have to not flinch. You cannot react. And you smile and you make it something into something new. And like,
Eddie Van Halen, actually, I just posted this on my YouTube channel. Eddie Van Halen has a quote where he's talking about the best advice he ever got was from his dad. And it was that, what do you do if you make a mistake? And his dad, Jan Van Halen, was a musician as well. And he said, you have a couple of choices. One is that you can smile and just look like that's what you wanted to happen, or you can do it again. And then it's not a mistake anymore.
Man, that's actually really similar to a John Coltrane thing. He's like, if you make a mistake, do it twice and then people will think you meant to do it.
Yeah.
I mean, how many times, man.
I was jamming with a friend of mine, Bern Euler, who is a great harmonica, blues harmonica guy. You know, he's actually a filmmaker, but his side gig. No, he just for fun, he plays harmonica. We were doing that one time and I was playing the piano and he's playing harmonica and I made a mistake, and then I just did it like 1,000 times. You know, it was like flubbed a note going down a scale, and so I just went blah, 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 and he went, dude, get it. It was a mistake, you made it right, move on, dude.
You're just gonna beat that dead horse.
it was a musical joke. I mean, there's language, and it was making a joke without talking, you know, and he got the joke.
And I don't think any of that stuff is undoable for even young musicians. You know what I mean? Like, you can play those with a single note. You can play those musical jokes, da, 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 da. And then, you know, like there's a response there and they're kind of playing along. And I think in my own experience with a lot of those creative verbs in particular, they were after you knew everything else. You get to creativity afterwards. And that's just not the reality of humanity. Like, we are creative by nature. My 8-month-old son now is constantly improvising with sounds. He's like babbling and he's finding sounds that make himself laugh, and you know, and it's beautiful. It's
and beautiful. Then in that podcast, Everyday Musicality,
Heather Schuldeis. Yeah.
Yeah. So Schuldeis talks about that as well, is that at a certain point of language development, I guess this comes from Edwin Gordon. But it's that's the babies don't realize that they're not actually repeating what you said. So if you go ba 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 and they go ba, you know, they don't realize the difference. They think they just repeated what you said. So it takes time for them to recognize or to replicate it accurately.
Sure. And sometimes that's not the purpose. Like if you're on a jazz gig and you're just repeating everything in this call and response, it gets boring, right? Like that's not human either. Like
I was watching,
there's this repetition, variation. Like, you know, it's,
I was watching some Led Zeppelin stuff the other day, just like some of their live stuff. I think it's fair to say they never played anything live the way it was on the recording. And that's not because they couldn't. It wasn't their goal. Their goal was to turn it into something else.
Oh man.
There's a big debate that I'm in on Facebook right now with a group of Prince music lovers.
Oh, I love Prince.
He does a version. Have you heard his acoustic version of Johnny Be Good?
No, I don't think I have.
I think genius. I just think it's so cool, because not to take away from Johnny B. Goode or Chuck Berry, but he has a totally different approach, and it's messy, and it's like, I don't know. I just think it's super cool. And like I posted, just, it's so Prince to take something that is such a classic and turn it into something that's 10 times better. And man, the response to that, you know, how dare you? What are you talking about? This is terrible. This is garbage. I don't know. And like, there are everything in there. And but I just thought, wow, what a different way of, what a great example of how we hear it differently, you know?
Yeah. And that taste is meant to be different.
Yes, exactly.
I'm happy to share my dissertation. My thesis, I had called it Reframing Creativity and Play in Music. My advisor, who I love and I absolutely recommend him to anyone, he's at USC. His name is Peter Webster. Dr. Webster is having me split it up into three separate papers. And one is hopefully going into pre-publication in a journal that he's involved with. So there's like a psychological portion of it, a practical portion for NAMFE, or NAMFE. And then there's a philosophical music education journal called, it's part of TAN Online, I think. So I'm going to split those up and then hopefully get those published and go from there. I love the process of it. And I think, talking to you, I think you'd really enjoy that process too, of like, you know, learning to build knowledge on top of each other, but linking it all together. It's really, it was so much fun, man. And it gave me that feeling that you and I were both looking for at the beginning, which was validating what it is that we do, even if it's strange, like there's reasons for it.
Yeah, I love that feeling that I got from Kobe. And I've said that talking with Chris, talking with Jennifer and with Anna Gower as well, that feeling, like it validated, like what I was doing, I wasn't crazy. There are other people who think this is a good thing. And a step beyond that now, because that's just what I felt that weekend when I was just sort of like going, people think that this is okay, you know? Yeah, speaking with you guys for this podcast, I've been like now filling in more gaps of the how to do that. Like, that's why I called this Approaches to Teaching and Learning, not because that's a catchphrase or something. It really was that, like, how do we actually do these things that we're talking about, you know?
I also, it sounds like you're doing a lot of great stuff in your school. So like, if you want to keep that collaboration going, I'm really happy to. I said this at kind of the end, I forgot to say it when I was doing the actual workshop. I'm really trying to get this idea of a modern music festival going. And part of the reason is because, you know, like one of the things that I did enjoy about being in like a band program was going on those trips together and like having that. And I didn't get that again until I was a touring professional musician.
Mm.
And it was always sad to me that the only way that that existed, at least in North America, was through competitions. And I just don't care about competition at all. That just, to me, perpetuates the idea of like perfectionism and all that. And that's cool. But like when I go to, you know, Fuji Rock or a big music festival, there's no like gold prize for number one. Like, that's just not what it's about. Like, I can personally decide I like that band, I didn't like that band, this was number one for me. But that's the taste, that individual taste is actually what I care about. And so I wanted to make an opportunity for our kids to also be able to travel internationally and do this. But I knew that I was going to have to like host it a couple of times. So this year we're doing it with the Canto Plains schools. And I've had a lot of great feedback from them, which is pretty wild because some of those schools are very performance oriented. But they're even like, you know, yearning for these kind of things. Not all of the schools, but some of the schools are, you know, like the DOD schools are like American schools, the Department of Defense schools. So it's like marching bands and stuff like that. And my only kind of like goal for this is that like a teacher can play in the band, but they can't lead the band. I don't want people like conducting up front. I want the kids to be like, you know, the center of this. That's the whole point of this. And any kind of modern music is totally welcome and interested. And eventually what I plan on doing is the first half of it will be kind of like master classes for those kids, then maybe like kind of some jam sessions of like cross-pollinations of schools, and then a concert at the end. So that's hopefully looking forward to getting that off the ground and getting lots of people involved.
I can say from my perspective, absolutely. I would love to be part of something like that. People can contact you as well who are interested in doing that.
Yeah, I mean, like I said, I've already gotten lots of great feedback. I mean, my main idea is that there is not an aspect of competition. There's not even really an aspect of adjudication after the fact. I don't really grade performance. I know that sounds weird. Like, I feel like they're grading themselves and they're enough. And like the joy of playing doesn't come from getting an A. You know, like that's not why I'm playing in a band a lot of times. And there's so many.
Sound crazy.
And so like for me, I just didn't think that this required that kind of like grading aspect and even feedback. Like I'd rather do that stuff up front. So that's why like the master classes beforehand, the cross-pollination of the kids together, I think that's going to be a lot of fun. And and a chance to, for these types of musicians that are playing in rock bands and hip hop bands and stuff that doesn't fit into AMI and a lot of those other things, a place for them to get together and share what they're doing and have that opportunity. So
I think it sounds really cool. I definitely would like to learn about how to be a part of that. And I'm sure there'd be a lot of people. As far as the grading stuff, I don't grade, I don't grade like the performance of something either, actually. But what I do is typically what I would do is I would ask students to reflect on their process to possibly performance, you know, and then
the process, man.
Yeah. You know, so sometimes it's also the performance, their feedback and their thoughts on it. And then we have that discussion, right? Because I think that is useful, whether it's the process, the performance, whatever, if they're thinking about it, we're talking about what we think about that together. You know, I think that's useful. Whereas for me,
that's cool, today,
you hit 17 correct notes and you hit 18 incorrect. So therefore you get, you know, it's like, that's not the way.
And like we said before, we don't even believe in correct notes. You know what I mean? Like, so it's really silly to me, but you know, I get like, that some people, you know, they thrive on that stuff, but it's just not for me.
Well, any band that I've ever been in, we do that. Like, after a practice or after a show, we'll say like, oh man, that version of such and such song, we nailed that part in the middle. Like when you did that thing on the drums and I caught it with the bass, you know, like we do that kind of reflection. We're not grading each other, you know?
No.
But there's like, for me, that feeds into my even subconscious level stuff of things that I'll try to replicate at some point in some way, you know, as a musician.
Yeah. Cool.
Yeah. That's
really absolutely. Yeah.
I love the idea of A, collaborating outside of this forum, but as well, I would love to have a follow-up chat with you at some point, maybe after I read your master's thesis. Yeah. I love this format for that, because then we can set a date and make it happen, you know?
Yeah, man, absolutely.
All right, Peter, really, cool, thank you so much. I really appreciate your absolutely. Giving your time like this.
Cool, man. Have fun. All right. Enjoy.
All right, thanks again. Talk to you Godspeed. Soon.
Don't forget to like and subscribe. Good night.